Hey, Pastor Edward Ondachi.
My name is Pastor Angie.
This is Pastor Victor Muthembwa.
Pastor Milton Jumba.
Hey, yo, Kevin Kilonzi.
Reverend Cheche.
Toki this right here.
This is Kevin Doria.
This is Pastor Njoro.
This is Pastor Godwin Mutai.
Welcome, Avuna South.
Wagwan Brooklyn.
Mambo VP Swahili Campus.
From downtown.
Crossroads, I hope you're there.
Mavuno Hill City.
Hey, Connect.
Mashariki.
Welcome. So glad you could join us this morning.
Your campus pastor.
Yuko hapa.
Adwadeka.
What's up, Mavuno Lifeway?
Tuko locked.
So glad to have you.
I hope you're watching. You know what it is.
Come on now.
Ngumi bado ni ngapi?
Mbwegze. Come on, man.
Hey, a very, very, very good morning. It's a cold morning, but you know what? We are very warm. Anyway, I'd just like to welcome you to the service today. Remember, the Bible says in the book of James chapter 4 verse 8, come near God and he will come near you. Like, let's just pause there for a minute. Come near God and he will come near you. So it doesn't matter what you're going through. God is just saying, you know what? Come close to me. I am right here with you. So this morning, I'd like to welcome you. Lean in. Let's enjoy a wonderful time in the presence of God. We're going to sing some good songs, some fun songs. They're going to warm us up a bit. So, you know, engage with us. Let's have a good time together. Are we ready? Are you guys ready?
Yeah.
I hope you are ready at home. So let's have a good time together. God bless you. Just move to the left and right like this. Come on. Hey.
We've come to praise you.
Oh,
we've come to love you.
Oh,
we've come to praise you
for the good things you have done.
We've come to praise you.
Oh,
we've come to love you.
Oh,
we've come to praise you
for the good things you have done.
We've come to praise you.
Oh,
we've come to love you.
Oh,
we've come to praise you
for the good things you have done.
We've come to praise you.
Oh,
we've come to love you.
Oh,
we've come to praise you.
You
hey,
have done.
Yahweh, you are worthy of my praise.
Hey, you are worthy of my praise.
Yahweh, you are worthy of my praise.
Hey, you are worthy of
sing.
My praise. Whoa, whoa, worthy of my
sing.
Praise.
To praise you.
Oh,
we've come to love you.
Oh,
we've come to praise you
for the good things you have done.
We've come to praise you.
Oh,
we've come to love you.
Oh,
we've come to praise you
for the good things you have done.
We've come to praise you.
Oh,
we've come to love you.
Oh,
we've come to praise you
for the good things you have done.
We've come to praise you.
Oh,
we've come to love you.
Oh,
we've come to praise you
for the good things you have done.
Yahweh, you are worthy of my praise.
Yeah, you are worthy of my praise.
Yahweh, 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 worthy of my praise.
Yeah, you are worthy of my praise.
Yahweh, 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 worthy of my praise.
Yeah, you are worthy of my praise.
To dance when you're seated,
yeah.
Especially me, like I'm just used to standing and dancing, really standing. But here's what we're gonna do: just move from left to right like this. Come on, hey, oh yeah, come on, come on, yeah, hallelujah, yeah, yeah.
Whoa, 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 worthy. of my praise. Oh, 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 worthy of my praise. Oh, oh,
Yahweh, Yahweh,
oh,
you are
worthy of my praise. Oh, 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 worthy of my praise.
Hallelujah.
Amen, amen.
Yeah, he's worthy of all our praise. And this morning, that's all we want to do. We want to give him all our praises. We are who we are today because of what he has done. He's yesterday, today, and forevermore the same. He never changes. Everything else might change, but he will never change. So this next song says Atawale. Atawale simply means Lord, come and reign. And probably you know it. We're going to do it a bit differently, but don't be afraid. Sing along with us and let's have a good time together. Amen.
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 Come on, just try to put your hands together like this. Come on. Hey, come on. Hey. Oh, yeah. We give you glory, Lord. Indeed, come and reign in our lives, Lord. Atawale, atawale, mwachi Yesu, atawale, say.
Atawale, atawale, mwachi Yesu.
Oh, atawale, atawale, mwachi Yesu, atawale.
Atawale, atawale, mwachi Yesu, atawale.
Hey, come and reign, Lord, come and reign. All the glory is yours, come and reign.
Come and reign, Lord, come and reign. All the glory is yours.
Akumama,
Yesu akumama, ena bomo inanga. Akumama,
hey akumama, Yesu akumama, ena bomo inanga. Akumama, hey
akumama, Yesu akumama, ena bomo inanga. Akumama.
Oh, say,
Mwachie Yesu atawale.
Oh, atawale, atawale. Mwachie Yesu atawale.
Atawale, atawale. Mwachie Yesu atawale.
Wamilele, wamilele, Mungu wa baraka ni Yesu we.
Wamilele, wamilele, Mungu wa baraka ni Yesu we.
Come on, say wamilele, wamilele, Mungu wa baraka. Yesu we.
Wa milele, wa milele, Mungu wa baraka ni Yesu we.
Wa milele, wa milele, Mungu wa baraka ni Yesu we.
Wa milele, wa milele, Mungu wa baraka ni Yesu we.
Wa milele, wa milele, Mungu wa baraka ni Yesu we.
Wa milele, wa milele, Mungu wa baraka ni Yesu
we. Wa baraka
ni Yesu.
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 Mungu wa baraka, wa baraka, Mungu wa baraka, wa baraka, Mungu wa baraka, wa baraka, na kotikate, Yesu aponanga banabo mwana,
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 na kotikate, Yesu aponanga.
Something so amazing about God. And this morning, God reminded me that it doesn't matter what we go through. It doesn't matter how many things break us. That at the end of the day, for as long as we hold on to Him, we have a promise of a future. And we can trust on His word. He's not a man that He would lie. If He promised that He will do it, He will do it for you. If He promised that He will bless you, He will bless you. And you know what? He's not limited by the economy. He's not limited by your boss. It's not limited by your family. There's so many things going on in the world right now. And people are constantly asking, what's next? Where are we going next? But this morning, God reminded me that we should be fearless. We should be bold and courageous. And take on every challenge that comes our way with the word of God. Because the word of God has a promise. A promise to give us a hope and a future and an expected. And nothing catches God by surprise. So this morning, I don't know where you are. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what situations that you're facing in life. But let me remind you that you have a God who loves you. You have a God who is there for you. You have an entire army, a legion of angels sent by God to protect and watch over you. So this next song basically just talks about how we are graciously broken, gracefully broken by God. Because God only breaks us to make us. God bless you. We love you, Lord. We give you glory, Jesus. Ooh, yeah.
and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Say all I have in these hands and multiply, God,
God,
all that I am, and find my heart
on the altar again.
Set me on fire, set me on fire. Thank you.
serve a God who breaks us, but not break us to put us down, not break us to destroy us, but break us to position us where He feels best. He breaks us to position us where He can use us best. Now, sometimes this is a hard truth to accept. This can be a hard truth to swallow, to know that life and all its joys sometimes have to be on hold, and sometimes we have to be in the valleys. But what we need to realize is that even in those valleys, we are not alone. The same way we look to God, the same way we are joyful, the same way we are hopeful, even when things are going well, He gives us His presence even when things are not. When things are hard, when things are not clear, when you're seeking God for breakthrough, He comes and He says, you know what? I'm breaking you, but I'm not destroying you. I'm breaking you, but I'm not finishing you. I'm breaking you, but this is not the end of the race. There could be someone who feels like I am done and I can't do this anymore, but this is God's message, special and straight just for you. This is not the end of the race. God is reminding you today that His promises still stand. He's reminding you today that you're still very much valuable to Him, that His promises apply to you, that you don't need any special qualification for His faithfulness to come in your life. God is saying, just as you are, with the little that you have, where you're at, where you're feeling unworthy, where you're feeling like you're not enough, He's saying, my faithfulness is made perfect in that. And so let's call on His promises right now. We're about to say that we're serving a God who will do it again. He's probably done it for you. He's probably done it for someone around you. But guess what? He can do it for you. And not only can He do it, but He can do it again. Thank you, Jesus, because you're a God who loves us. Thank you for the promise of a second chance. Thank you for the promise of lifting us up, Lord, when we are broken. Thank you for the promise of walking with us and holding our hand, dear Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And we say, your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. See, I'm still in your hand, and this is my confidence. God, you never fail me. Like you believe it at this point, just call on His promises right now. Your promise still stands.
Your faithfulness.
Has never failed, and He will not fail you. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
This one time I was coming home from school, and I noticed someone who was sleeping in a sack where ordinarily that place would be a cobbler's stand. Eh? So I had never seen that before. It was my first time to see someone who was homeless or sleeping outside. So I related that with what I had read in Isaiah 58, and it became a point of action for me. So I ran a library service prior to that, renting out books for a few shillings a day. So I got a client of mine to actually use their proceeds and go with me to feeding this one person that I had seen. So we could not find the one person. We found 15 others. So with the little money we had, we got to feed the 15 people that we saw. And that set up our journey to what we are today. My name is Brian Maremi, founder of Seren. Seren exists to make the dreams of micro-enterprise traders possible through a seed capital, working capital, and growth capital as required. And particularly, we have a heart for the homeless, street families, and the hawkers. Began becoming curious about those situations and circumstances, and we continue just feeding the people that we had seen. At the end of a year, we had gotten to feed 250 people a week, a total of 14,000 meals for about a year. So we got to build relationships, we got to understand some of the problems and challenges that they're going through. Having noticed these problems, we began a program to help the families become independent for about a year. And we noticed that the challenge was still at the point where they were starting businesses and they required finances to keep those businesses afloat. So we would come in through providing seed capital for starting enterprises that, you know, that are in their dreams, you know, dreams that they have of an enterprise. So we'd be able to help them start those enterprises. After starting, we'd be able to support them with working capital, and we'd also be able to finance them to grow those enterprises, so that then, you know, when you create a job for one person, they can be able to employ another and another. And consequently, as we create these jobs and improve incomes, we can be able to alleviate poverty. We approach communities of street families and homeless people, and we do every month we take them. We have a fellowship, a streets fellowship, so we get to talk about God and life, and then we couple that with business. So financial training, talking about how enterprises, the life cycle of enterprises, and, you know, the challenges that they may have already faced since many of them have already tried to start enterprises. And then we'd be able to talk about how to counter those challenges and talk about the common pitfalls. And then from there, we'd offer facilities to the people who would need them. We're seeing people now able to take care of their families, now getting, you know, dignity. And now they're becoming businessmen and women, you know? Yeah, ready for transformation and change. My name is Brian Moremi, and it's time to be brave.
Some of you are like me. Growing up, for you, Christianity was this thing that you're supposed to do. You get saved so that you don't go to hell. It was like divine fire insurance. As I've grown older, I've come to realize that's not what this thing was. That's not what Jesus came to do, to save us so that we can wait and go to heaven one day. It's not this irrelevant thing, this opium of the masses. Your faith is actually meant to be the thing that turbocharges your life and makes you the agent that God can use to change your world. And that's what Fearless Summit is about. You know, I'm so excited. Fearless Summit starts in less than a week, 20th to 26th July. Meaning it's going to be such a fantastic opportunity. What we do is every year we do this Fearless Summit, and it's a place for you to get to hear from leaders all over the world, every sector of society whose faith has been turned into relevance, and it's changing the world. And this one's coming soon. Every year we've always had a huge gathering. We charge people for it. But this year, for the first time, it's actually free of charge. It's all going to be virtual. Everyone and anyone can come for it. The only thing is, you actually have to register and get a ticket. So head over to fearlesssummit.org and book yourself a seat. Make sure you're there 20th to 26th. That's all we're doing. We're doing Fearless Summit. That's what it's going to be about. And I can't wait to see you. Let's turn our faith to relevance. Let's be the spark.
Thank you so much. We are so excited that you chose to worship with us this morning. And let me just say, we have been praying for you as the Mavuno pastoral team, even as we go through these uncertain times. For those who may not know me, my name is Pastor Anthony Njoroge, and I'm one of the pastors here at Mavuno Church. Would like to know where you're watching us from. Please, on the comment section, just let us know where you're watching us from. But also, if you have a prayer request, you can actually just share your prayer request, and I believe that God is going to bless you. I just want to say that no matter what is happening in us, all around us, God is good. He's still on the throne, and he's still faithful. And so we have been praying for you, and we are trusting you for miracles and for breakthroughs, and for God to come and heal you, for God to come and comfort you, and even to strengthen you for those who are going through these tough times. Let me just say that we began a new series called Unstuck, and it's just been so amazing just to listen. You know, Pastor Angie and Pastor Kilonzi, it's really been a powerful, powerful series. You know, we are living in very difficult moments. We are living in times of fear and great uncertainty. You know, and one of the things that I've realized during this season is, you know, it seems like God is so distant. you know, making many of us, you know, we don't want even to engage when it comes to matters of faith. And it's during moments like this that if someone right now will say, you know what, you need to follow Jesus, we don't know even where to start. We feel jaded. We feel like we are, there's that sense of being overwhelmed by what is happening around us, and we don't know where to start. And right now, even as I begin this sermon, you know, maybe you're there and you feel stuck in your faith. Maybe life has beaten you down and God seems so distant like never before. Or maybe you're struggling with doubt or skepticism, or maybe you're struggling to follow God. I want to say, if you're listening to me right now, that is very, very understandable. You know, it's okay in this season, you know, in this kind of a season, to actually struggle. Why? Because personally, I've struggled in this season. And my hope and prayer is that as we go through this series of Unstuck, you're going to be ready and willing to take a step or two towards, you know, in our journey of faith in the midst of this uncertain season. And we're going to look at some of the practical steps on how we can be unstuck and follow Jesus and become committed followers of our Lord Jesus Christ. So I want to pray right now, and you can just join me as we pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for every single person who is listening to us right now, wherever they are. I pray that, God, you may give us understanding. I ask you, Lord, that, Lord, we are going just to hear what you want us to hear. And this word will not come to us void. It must accomplish its purpose. I pray for utterance. I pray that I will decrease and you will increase, in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I remember many years ago when I gave my life to Jesus. And out of curiosity, I had this spiritual mentor. His name was David from, you know, he was a Costerian. And out of curiosity, I came to him and I asked him, you know, now that I am a believer, what is the benefit of my decision to follow Christ? What is the end game? What is the reward? What is the payoff? You know, I don't know if you're like me. I love knowing the end game. I love knowing what I'm working towards. It kind of gives you the morale, you know, to work towards something when you know what is the payoff, what is the reward, what's the benefit. And so I asked, you know, my spiritual mentor then called David, and I said, you know, I want you to break down for me, what is the benefit, what is the reward of my followership of Jesus Christ? And, you know, he was very kind enough. And he broke down for me the benefits of being a Christ follower. And I remember him telling me, you know what, Njoro, because you follow Christ, you're going to go to heaven. And I was like, oh my goodness. And he shared the stories of the gold paved roads and the mansion in heaven. You know, my mansion being near a great, mighty and man of God, you know. And I was like, oh wow, I could just picture. And I was so excited by that. And then he said, on top of that, you know, because now you're a Christ follower, you're going to become a better person. And he said, you know what, you're going to be able to forgive quickly. You're going to be more generous. You're going to be more loving, you know. You're going to be more kind. You don't have to worry about the things you used to worry. You know what, Njoro, because of your decision to follow Jesus, you're going to become a better person. And then he was like, you know what? He said, there's something else I need to tell you, Njoro. And he said, because of your decision to follow Jesus, God is going to sort out all your problems. And I was like, oh my goodness, this one I needed to hear. Because during that season, when I gave my life to Jesus, as a family, we were going through one of the hardest seasons in our time, in our family. You know, and I was like, oh my goodness, I wanted to hear that. And he said, yes, Jesus is going to sort out all your problems. And I was like, this is really awesome. You know, as I look back, I thank God for the things my mentor taught me in regard to my journey of faith. But now, after 20 years of following Jesus, with hindsight, as I look at my journey, and you know, as I look at my relationship with Jesus, I've realized that there is more to following Jesus than what my mentor told me. There is more. There is more to following Jesus than heaven. You know, when I read the gospel, I don't see anywhere where Jesus said, I want you to follow me so that you can go to heaven. And by the way, it's okay. By the way, that's our ultimate reward. But when it comes to the payoff here on earth, I don't see anywhere Jesus saying, I want you to give your life to Jesus so that you can go to heaven. Or I've never seen in the gospel where Jesus has said, I want you to follow me so that you can become a better person. It's okay. And it's awesome. God transforms us for us to become better people. But that's not the only reward of my followership of our Lord Jesus Christ. I know some of the best people, you know, the best people in the world are actually Jesus's followers. But I want to say that's not the end game. That's not the only payoff. That's not the only reward, you know. And then, you know, it's more than just Jesus solving my problems. We don't follow Jesus so that my problems or my pain will vanish. I want to say right now with all authority, that is magic. That's not Christianity, you know. That's magic. That's not Christianity at all. Unfortunately, for some of us, we have been raised in a Christian environment where the magic thinking has got mixed in with Jesus thinking. And the next thing you know, we are trying, you know, to do some certain things so that God can bless us. Oh, you need to give this amount of money for, you know, for you to get the miracle or for your problems to disappear or for your pain to vanish or your suffering to end. And we have been caught up into doing things so that now God can bless us or to get God to give us a charm and a lucky life. And, you know, and I want to say that is not why we follow Jesus. Then I have a question for us this particular morning. If heaven or being a better person or having a problem-free, pain-free life are not the rewards of following Jesus, then what is the payoff? What is the end game of our decision to follow Christ? I want us to look into the scripture. A conversation that Jesus was having with his disciples in the book of Matthew chapter 10. And we're going to discover the finish line. We're going to discover the payoff. We're going to discover the place that our Heavenly Father wants to lead us. Can I say this right now? There is a place that Jesus wants to lead you and me as we follow Christ. There is a space, there is a place where Jesus wants to lead you and me as we make a decision to follow Christ. Heaven is good. Being a better person is good. You know, our problems disappearing, we all would love that. But there is a place, there is a reward, there is a payoff, there is a benefit that Jesus wants to lead us. And today, you're going to discover the payoff as we become or as we decide to become Jesus's followers. So we're going to read Matthew chapter 10. But before I do that, let me give you a bit of a context to our scripture this morning. So Matthew chapter 10 is the beginning of Jesus' ministry. And one day Jesus gathered a whole bunch of his followers together and he chose his 12 disciples. And right now they are all famous and they are coming, you know, everybody is just once, they are so popular. People want to get to Jesus. And so at this particular time, as Jesus, it was so common during that day when a teacher or a rabbi will actually, you know, select, handpick some people to become his followers. And so Jesus selects these 12 people to become his disciples. And that's the context of Matthew chapter 10. He selects them and he's talking to them and it's a conversation as he tells them about their decision to follow Christ and what is to come in the future. And so he reveals the payoff, the reward, the end game, the finish line of following him in this particular discussion. And so here's what I want us to read, Matthew chapter 10. And we're going to start from verse 16 to 17. And you're just going to track with me. The Bible says, look, I'm sending you out as sheep among wolves. So be as shrewd as snakes and harmless as doves. But beware, for you'll be handed over to the courts and be flogged with whips in the synagogues. Let me pause over there. So Jesus can appear into the future because the gospel is all about Jesus. And the book of Acts is actually, you know, the story about these guys and in the future. And sure enough, whatever Jesus was telling them actually came to pass. It actually took place. But they're not experiencing or they're not expecting this right now, because at this particular time, they are popular. I mean, there are so many thousands of people everywhere. Jesus goes, and the closer you are to Jesus, the more popular you are. And so the disciples were popular. But in the midst of all that, Jesus said, something is going to change. This, what you see, the popularity, is going to change. You are going to be arrested. You're going to be flogged in the synagogue. And when you get flogged, you're going to have a permanent record. Wherever you go, people will know that you have broken the law. And so let's go to verse 18 to 20. You will stand trial before governors and kings because you're my followers. But this will be your opportunity to tell the rulers and other believers about me. When you're arrested, don't worry about how to respond or what to say. God will give you the right words at the right time. For it is not you who will be speaking. It will be the Spirit of God, the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. So Jesus said, he tells them, you're going to become witnesses, not just to the Jews, but also to the Gentiles. And he says, you know, moreover, when you're arrested, you know, I want you to know this, that God, through the Holy Spirit, is going to give you the right words to speak. And I was like, come on, Jesus. For me, what I want at that particular time, I don't want words. I want freedom. I want Jesus to come and free me. But Jesus is like, no. At that particular time, the Holy Spirit will give you the right words to speak. Let's look to verse 21 to 27. A brother will betray his brother to death, and a father will betray his own child. And children will rebel against their parents and cause them to be killed. And all nations will hate you because you are my followers. But everyone who endures to the end will be saved. But when you are persecuted in town, flee to the next. I tell you the truth. The Son of Man will return before you have reached all the towns of Israel. Students are not greater than their teacher, and the slaves are not greater than their master. Students are to be like their teacher, and slaves are to be like their master. And since I, the master of the household, have been called the prince of demons, the members of my household will be called by even worse names. But don't be afraid of those who threaten you, for the time is coming when everything that is covered will be revealed, and all that is secret will be known, made known to all. What I tell you now in the darkness, shout abroad when daybreak comes. What I whisper in your ear, shout from the housetops for all to hear. They've got to be thinking at this particular time, no one told us about this part. I mean, right now, everybody loves us because of you. People can't even get close to you without, you know, going through us. But right now, Jesus is saying, you know what, God's people? You know what, my disciples? You will be isolated. You will be lonely. You will be hated. You will be persecuted. You'll be called all manner of names. Bad things are going to happen to you. And then, in verse 28, he says, but, listen to verse 28. Don't be afraid of those who want to kill your body. They cannot touch your soul. Fear only God, who can destroy both your soul and body in hell. What is the price of two sparrows? One copper coin. But not a single sparrow can fall to the ground without your father knowing it. And the very hairs on your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are more valuable to God than a flock of sparrows. The disciples are like, but you're going to be arrested. I know. You're going to be arrested. But he said, do not be afraid. You're going to be beaten and flogged, but do not be afraid. You're going to be called all manner of names. You're going to stand on trial for your lives. And you know, and everybody is going to turn against you. But in the midst of all that, I don't want you to be afraid. Do not be afraid. And Jesus, at that particular time, introduces to us the good news, the payoff, the reward, the benefit of our decision to follow Christ. And this is it. Being able to find ourselves in very difficult circumstances and yet to refuse to allow fear to take hold of us. That is the payoff. That Jesus was saying, I want you guys to follow me because suffering is gonna come. You're gonna have problems. You're gonna go through pain. You will be hated. You will be called names. You will be lonely. You will be isolated. You will be tried. But listen, I wanna lead you to a place that even as you face these things, your fear, You will not allow fear to take hold of us. That's what I want. I'm not promising you a life that has no problem or pain. But I want you to follow me in the year 2020 so that when you go through what you're going through, you will not allow your fear to hold on, to take hold of us. That in the midst of your pain and suffering, do not be afraid. Why? Jesus said, you are more worth than the sparrows. And this is where Jesus wants to take you and me as his followers. He wants to take us to a place where our faith in God is so big, is so strong. He wants us to take us to a place where we feel secure in our Father's love, even in the midst of our circumstances. Yes, I got saved or I became a Christ follower because I want to go to heaven. That's awesome. That is my ultimate reward. But here on earth, I didn't just follow Jesus to become a better person. I didn't just follow Jesus to eradicate my pain or my suffering. No, I am following Jesus so that he can grow my faith to a place where my faith is going to become so big and so strong that, you know what? I will not doubt his love even when I am flogged. I will not doubt his love even when I go through pain. And that's where God wants to take us. When it looks like our God has forgotten us, we were going to hear the whisper of his voice saying, fear not, I am with you. So Jesus, you see, the message of Jesus was not, don't be afraid. I won't let bad things happen to you. No, 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 no. Jesus is like, don't be afraid when bad things happen. That's confidence in God, and confidence that is so big, that is so sure of God's presence, that is so sure of God's love, that is so sure of God's protection. It is a faith that is so big that actually overwhelms and overshadows our fear in Jesus' name. That is the place God wants to lead us. A place where your faith will overwhelm and overshadow your fear. This morning, Jesus says, I want you to follow me. I want you to follow me because that is a place I want to take you. I'm going to take you to a place not of denial, not of deception, not of trickery, not a place to figure out a formula or get a code for Jesus to do what I want. No, Jesus wants to take you to a place where your faith in him, your faith in your heavenly Father is going to be so confident, even in the midst of circumstances that should terrify you, that you will not be afraid in Jesus' name. So when your confidence in God, he tells his disciples in one particular space, place in the Sermon on the Mount, he tells them that when you have confidence in God, you're not going to be controlled by your fear. You're not going to bother about what you eat, what you wear, because that's what the pagans think. And Jesus was telling them, I don't want you to think about these things because your heavenly Father already knows that you need those things. That your confidence it's in the one who controls, who knows your name, who shields your soul. That your confidence in God is so big that even in the midst of your circumstances, where everybody else is afraid, you do not need to fear. This is where following Jesus ultimately leads us. As I share this message, this is my story. Many times there are moments where I have doubted God's love. My faith has been shaken. There are moments where I felt, what is the need of my following Jesus? Well, what is the need? All I see is pain and suffering. There are moments where I felt like quitting in ministry. And I'm like, I wish I never said yes to the call of God. I've contemplated leaving ministry. I felt like running away, you know, and I was like, I was so mad with God. Because I'm like, God, you could have prevented this particular calamity from coming. You could have prevented my brother from dying. You could have prevented this pain. I've been there. And maybe some of you, that's where you are. Right now, your business has died. Or you're looking at a possibility. You're going to close your business. Right now, maybe there is someone in your family who is suffering from a terminal disease. Maybe right now, wherever you are, you're struggling because you've been laid off. You're looking at your teenage children and you're like, why are they departing from the values and the principles I've taught them? You're looking at right now, you're like, I have no source of income right now. And you're struggling. You're doubting God's love. You're wondering what to do. Listen, These are circumstances that will make you fearful or doubt His love for you. But today God is speaking to you, my dear brother, my dear sister. And God is saying to you, I want you to follow me so that your confidence in God will overwhelm your fear. We don't follow Him to be a better person or to go to heaven. No, we are following God so that we can have a fearless faith that believes that God knows your name. God knows your name. He knows what you need. His presence is right there with you wherever you are. And God loves you in spite of what you see. Why would that be the end game? Because at the end of the day, when we have that confidence in God, when we have that kind of a faith, it honors God. It honors God. Fearless faith honors God. We honor God with our big, audacious, bold, out-of-the-box kind of a faith. Maybe I've heard someone, people who normally say, God is going to take care of it. Oh, I believe in God. And maybe you're like, these guys are in denial. These guys, they don't know what they're saying. These guys have been brainwashed, you know. Like, why would someone go through what they are going through and say God, that God is still in control, that all things work together for good? I know, I've met those kind of people and I'm like, say what? This is denial. They are denying the reality. But I've come to realize it is not about denial. These people have followed Christ to the point where they have a faith that overshadows, that overwhelms their fear. They are cognizant of what is happening around them, but they are aware there is a God who controls the universe. There is a sovereign God who is there with them, who is going to lead them, who is going to fight for them. And that's why they have the confidence to say that all things will work out together for my good. As we come to finish, I want to say to you right now, maybe you're like, I would love that of a faith, that kind of a faith, Pastor Njoro. I want to be that kind of a person that when the devil brings whatever he's going to bring, when I'm going through my pain and my suffering and the calamities of life, right now, I want my faith to say, I have confidence in God that my life, that I am worth more than a sparrow, that God is going to take care of me. There is a faith that overwhelms fear. And that's where your Savior wants to lead you. And one day you're going to say like Paul, in the book of Romans chapter 8, is there anything that can separate me from the love of God? Joblessness will not separate me. Death cannot separate me. Pain cannot separate me. You can enjoy. You can reach a place where you can actually also confess and say, nothing, absolutely nothing can separate me from the love of God. You can be there. And Jesus wants you to lead you into that space where you can say that indeed my faith can overshadow and overcome all my fears, because that's the payoff of following Jesus. I want to invite you to take these four steps as I finish my sermon this morning. This is the ABCD steps I want you to take, very memorable. A, I want you to admit this morning that your faith has been weak, that your desire to follow Him to the place where your desire is to follow Him to the place where your faith overcomes your fears, but your faith has been weak. Right now, I am looking at someone who stopped following God because of your faith, because of your problem. You said it doesn't count much. There is no need of following Jesus and yet go through this kind of pain and yet go through this kind of calamity and yet face this kind of difficulty. And maybe you backslid and you left God. Today God is calling you back home and He's saying, I didn't want you to follow me so that you can have a life that has, you know, that is problem free, that is pain free. No. I wanted you to follow me so that when problems come, when pain comes, your faith will overwhelm and overshadow your fear in Jesus' name. He wants you to lead you to that place where your faith in God overcomes your fear. B, belong to a small group. This kind of faith does not grow in isolation. You need to be in a space where you can be encouraged and learn from others. And as a follower of Jesus, I want to encourage you, don't walk alone. And that's why I'm so excited that we have launched Mizizi as the Mavuno Movement. And Mizizi is a 10-week experience where you get to connect with God, where you connect with purpose, where you connect with your community, and you do it as a group. You encourage each other. The Bible says two are better than one. And we're going to start Mizizi. And if you desire to start this journey, there is a number on the bottom of the screen. I want you to send your name and the details or go to our website, www.mavunocha.org. And I want you to actually sign up for this amazing experience. It's going to change your life. I've done it. And my faith has been reignited and I've grown in the Lord. Three, which is C, contribute to God's work. We grow in our faith by serving through our God-given gifts and talents. Maybe some of you have stopped serving because of your problems, because of your pain, because of what you're going through life. The other day I called someone, I said, hey, do you mind serving in a particular ministry? And they said, Pastor Njoro, I cannot serve right now because of what I'm going through. I'm like, that's the lie of the devil. You shouldn't stop contributing to God's work because of your issues. That's what fear does. We run away when we should be offensive and moving forward. The last one, which is D, disciple others to follow Jesus. Disciple others to follow Jesus. Let me say this. Our faith grows when we help others to follow Jesus. Your spiritual muscles are strengthened and they grow when you teach others what you are learning. The more you give, the more you receive. I remember when I gave my life to Jesus, I started discipling people only 1 year into salvation. Only 1 year. I wasn't theologically, astute. I didn't know everything in the Bible. But I said, whatever I am learning, I can teach others. And that's how my faith has grown. And I want to invite you today. Maybe some of you need to disciple, you need to lead others to do Mizizi. Maybe you need to take through your cousins through Mizizi. Maybe it's your neighbors. Maybe it's an accountability group. What if maybe you say, hey, I want to lead you through Mizizi. Why? We don't wait to mature to disciple others. No, we mature as we disciple others. Let me say that again. You don't mature, you don't wait to mature so that you can disciple others. No, you mature as you disciple others. And so maybe right now you need to say, yes, I want to disciple others, because that's how our faith grows. I want to pray right now to someone, with someone. Maybe you're here. You stopped following Jesus because of your problems. You backslid. You threw your hands and said, this thing about church and following Jesus doesn't make sense to me. I got saved so that I can be insulated from my problems. But now I want to say, you didn't get saved so that you can be insulated from your problems. You got saved so that God can lead you to a place where your faith, your confidence in God can overwhelm and overshadow your fear. And right now I want to pray for you. Maybe you've never given your life to Jesus. I want to pray this prayer to you right now. Wherever you are, you're saying, Pastor Njoro, I would love to follow Jesus. Can I say, our problems is not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. Problems are part of us as long as we are here on earth. Pain is part of us. Difficulty is part of us. Suffering is part of us. But you can be in a place where you follow Jesus, where your faith, your confidence in God overwhelms your fear. And right now I want to pray for you. If you're backslidden, or maybe you've never said this prayer to follow Jesus, say after me. Dear Jesus, I thank you for your love. I thank you for your grace. This morning, I confess of all my sins. I ask you for your forgiveness. Come into my heart and be the Lord my Savior. I make a commitment today to follow you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you have made that prayer, I want you to write to us and just say, hey, Pastor Njoro, I made that prayer. Somebody's going to call you up. Somebody's going to follow you up. And I believe you're going to be blessed. I want to pray for the last group of people. People who are going through tough times. That your faith will stand firm and not fall away. That your confidence will overwhelm and overshadow your fear. So I want to pray for all of us right now. Maybe right now you're facing a sickness that the doctors have said, we are only giving you 2 months, 3 months a year. Maybe right now your business has been closed. Maybe you lost your job. Maybe right now you're looking at a possibility where maybe there is a divorce or there is a separation. Your marriage is not in a good place. Your children are prodigal sons and daughters. They have left home. They no longer listen to you. I want to pray for you that your faith will stand firm. You will know that God knows your name, that God knows what you need, that He's able to fight for you because He's a great warrior. So I want to pray for you right now. Father, in Jesus' name, there is my brother, my sister right now who is going through a hard situation, a hard season. They are facing, my Father, closure of their business. Lord, maybe someone has terminal illness or disease. Right now, Lord, their marriage is going through a hard time. And Father, Lord, they don't know what to do. They lost their job. Their children are becoming disobedient. Right now, they have been trusting you for a child, and it's been years. God, I pray their faith will stand firm. Lord, they will gonna put their faith in you, knowing that, my God, you know them by name. You know what they need. You are a God who is able to move the mountains. You are the God who can make a way where there seems to be no way. You are the God who makes water to come out of a rock. You are the God who can slay the giants in our lives. I pray right now you may come through for them, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And I pray that, my Father, you may lead them to a place where their faith will overwhelm their fear, will overshadow their fear. Give them strength. Give them the grace to go on. They will not fall away. They will not look back, but they're gonna stand and say, regardless of what happens, I believe God, that God is gonna make everything to work out for my good. And as Paul said, nothing will separate me from the love of God. I send the Holy Spirit right now, wherever you are. May you feel encouraged. May faith rise up right now that you're going to look and see a God in the midst of your pain. You're going to see the hand of God in the midst of your suffering. Your eyes will be opened up and you're going to see that greater is He that is in you than he who is in the world. I bless you now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. And see you next week.
Wow, thank you so, so much for worshiping with us. My name is Pastor M, and I'm so excited. Was that an amazing message from Pastor Njoro? What a powerful word. And you know, I believe that God wants us to be about His business, not because we're perfect, not because we have anything that we are so good at, but simply because His grace is sufficient. He's forgiven us. He's called us into partnership with Him. And one of the ways that we partner is through discipling others, through helping others grow in the steps that we are taking ourselves. Again, not because you're a pastor or because you're so perfect, but simply because God has been good to you and you can pass that goodness on. You can pay it forward to someone else. So we want to challenge you in this next month to get a group together, maybe the same group you did the Proverbs with, and take them through Mizizi. Maybe take your family through it. This is a transformation course that we're going to put online. We're going to help you with it, and we're going to help you be able to take those steps that you can actually equip the friends around you with it. And one of the best and most natural places to do equipping is through your family as well, which is why we always encourage you to make sure that as you're listening and as you're worshiping together on Sunday, that you're actually creating a micro church in your home. So go around after this sermon, ask everybody to share what is one thing that spoke to them, and then say a prayer after that, and just allow that to be a place of agreement for you as a family or with your roommates or whoever it is that you watch this broadcast with. Hey, Fearless starts tomorrow. So, so excited about that. I can't wait. Whatever part of the world you're going to be watching from, let's just join in together. If you haven't yet, please make sure that you register for it. Get your pass to be part of it. It's going to be big. It's going to be the best Fearless we've ever had. If you're able to, there's a donate button there as well. You can give towards Fearless and towards us making a difference in the society. And also you can share. If your friends don't know about Fearless, make sure that you share about it. And I just want to conclude by saying thank you so much for your generosity. You're such an amazing congregation. Thank you for your continually giving towards God's work. And hey, if you're interested in continuing to give, you know our M-Pesa number is 508-700. It's on your screen right now, as well as other forms of giving that you can give. You can give tithe or offering. You can designate that. You can designate it to a certain campus, Mavuno campus as well. Or you can simply say spread hope. And when you put Spread Hope as your account number, then we give it towards the community. We make sure that every designated account that goes towards Spread Hope goes towards families that are struggling in these times, in these hard economic times, and becomes a blessing to them. Thank you for helping us to be a blessing to the world around us. God bless you. See you at Fearless.
Serve a God who breaks us, but not break us to put us down, not break us to destroy us, but break us to position us where He feels best. He breaks us to position us where He can use us best. Now, sometimes this is a hard truth to accept. This can be a hard truth to swallow, to know that life and all its joys sometimes have to be on hold, and sometimes we have to be in the valleys. But what we need to realize is that even in those valleys, we are not alone. The same way we look to God, the same way we are joyful, the same way we are hopeful, even when things are going well, He gives us His presence even when things are not. When things are hard, when things are not clear, when you're seeking God for breakthrough, He comes and He says, you know what? I'm breaking you, but I'm not destroying you. I'm breaking you, but I'm not finishing you. I'm breaking you, but this is not the end of the race. There could be someone who feels like I am done and I can't do this anymore, but this is God's message, special and straight just for you. This is not the end of the race. God is reminding you to...